Welcome to the virtual book launch for The View from Split Rock Lighthouse, A Keeper's Life by Lee Radzak and Curt Brown. I'm Hayes Scriven, the current site manager here at Split Rock Lighthouse. Lee was the site manager at Split Rock Lighthouse from 1982 to 2019. And in his book with journalist and author Curt Brown, Lee takes readers into the everyday experience, the remarkable surprises, and the seasonal round of the life of the lighthouse keeper at Split Rock. He also discusses stories of its keepers and technology that powered the light and the foghorns, the stunning landscape, the weather of the North Shore, and his decision in 1985 to light the beacon in memory of the crew of the SS Edmund Fitzgerald. Curt Brown is a writer, writes a popular Minnesota history column for the Minneapolis Star Tribune, and is the author of two books, So Terrible a Storm, A Tale of Fury on Lake Superior, and Minnesota 1918, When Flu, Fire, and War Ravaged the State. Tonight, I will talk with Lee and Curt for a while, and then we'll respond to your questions. So please feel free to post your comments and questions in the chat. So Lee, we are going to get going right here, and we're going to start off with the basic question of what led you to the job of site manager at Split Rock, and what were your main responsibilities? I get that question quite a bit of what do I actually do here?
Well, thanks, Hayes. It's great to be here. Great to do this. Yeah, that's the question that everybody asks. How'd you get this job? Why did you want this job? It worked out perfectly for me. In 1982, Jane and I had been married for 3 months, and I had been an archaeologist, and that job came to an end. State funding ran out on that. The Split Rock job opened up with the Minnesota Historical Society, and I applied for it. Had to go through a few interviews with a few different people down in St. Paul, and luckily got the position. The main criteria, of course, as we know, is living on site, and not everybody's willing to do that or interested in doing it. And Jane and I were happy, excited about it, and we took it on. And on November 1st, 1982, moved up to Split Rock.
And if I remember too, Lee, wasn't one of the first things that you had to do here, put the storm windows on all the
Yeah, they should have really been on in September on the North Shore. And the site manager prior to me, Tom Ellig, had left for a new job in southern Minnesota, I think about September 1st. So he left, and the screen windows were still on the windows when we came in November. So I was up on a ladder in a snowstorm putting storm windows up. And it's funny, you talk to people, visitors to the site from southern states, and they don't understand the concept of storm windows, but they're pretty critical up there.
They are very critical, and they keep the house nice and toasty warm. That is for sure. Speaking of seasons, the book that you and Curt wrote, it's divided into seasons. So, this is for both of you, Lee and Curt. Lee, what is your favorite season?
I probably, like everybody else, late summer and fall is a great time, but everybody thinks the same thing. So it's pretty crazy. It's the one time of year when the weather is perfect. It's ideal. I got to say winter is probably our favorite time. It was our favorite time of year. It was the quietest time of the year, people-wise, but there was the most going on as far as weather, I think. The storms, the lake freezing, different things happening that didn't happen at other times of the year, but there were a lot less people around. So we kind of had the place to ourselves, and we really did enjoy being able to have that time, a little interim between seasons where we could kind of catch our breath and get ready for the next spring.
Yeah. Curt, what's your favorite season?
Well, first I should just say thanks for having me on the show tonight. This is kind of exciting. I just want to say what an honor it was to help Lee kind of tell his story. I joked with Lee that you build the house and I'll paint the house. Mm-hmm. And we really had fun. You talk about a perfect pandemic project. Lee would email me great stories of life on the lighthouse, and I'd fiddle around as his designated word dink, and it was just a fun process. I'll have to then give the cliche answer, because certainly fall on the North Shore of Lake Superior is such a beautiful time when the leaves are changing. I mean, there's a lot of people around, so I know that some people wouldn't like the crowds, but with crimson leaves and the yellows and the golds and you know, what a gorgeous time to be up on the North Shore.
Yeah. Fall is definitely a magical time up here, but I'm going to go with Lee on this. I really love winter. It's the so different, it's otherworldly out here. And when it's negative 25 and the lake is just steaming, or the sunrise beams across the lake, just crimson red. It's a different kind of time. Curt, how did you get involved with this project?
Well, you know, I've lived in Minnesota for about 40 years, and my wife, Adele, and I moved out to Colorado to kind of stage second acts about 7 years ago. And I've written a couple books in the northeastern Minnesota genre. One you mentioned earlier was about a big storm and shipwrecks in 1905. And then more recently, we look back at the horrible year of 1918 with the war and the flu and the fire. And Josh Leventhal, editor at the Historical Society Press, kind of knew I had a little extra time on my hands as I eased towards retirement. So when the idea came that a Lee Radzak memoir would be a good idea, he just thought, you know, my name popped into his head, and I'm thrilled and honored that he tapped me out of the bullpen to come back in and help with this project, because it was just so much fun. And I think readers are really going to enjoy, as Lee and I take you through the seasons at Split Rock and tell you some nature stories. And it's kind of a nice escape from the tough year we've had to just kind of escape on the clifftop of Split Rock Lighthouse for 40,000 words and lots of pretty pictures.
Why don't you guys walk us through a little bit about the process? Because, you know, Lee, you're writing about your life, and I know that's kind of a little awkward every once in a while. And, you know, you're working with Curt, who's like this super uber professional, as he called himself, a word dink. You know, how did you guys work together? How did this all come together? Because it's an amazing, it's a great book.
Yeah, it was interesting because I had another, right about retirement time 2 years ago, I had another press publication, University of Minnesota, asked if I was interested in a book. And I said, I have to give rights of first refusal to MNHS Press because that's who I work for. And they said, yeah, let's do a book. And so they approached me and said, that'd be a great idea. Let's do it. And, you know, I had never written a book. I've written plenty of publications for Lighthouse magazines and that sort of thing. And when they suggested Curt, I thought, wow, I couldn't get luckier, because I'd read Curt's books. I knew about Curt, his column in the Star Tribune on his Minnesota history. And, you know, he's being pretty modest saying that he was I built the house and he painted it. Not to mix metaphors, but that's like having a Rembrandt or a Hemingway paint your house for you, because he really knows the history. He has access to a lot of the genealogical information, the research information through the newspaper, and that really helped back up some of the stories and make them flush them out and make them fuller. And, you know, he helped me with a lot of the just putting the grammar together and the sentences in the right order and making sure everything fit well. So it was really appreciated that he had that knowledge and expertise and was willing to do it.
I'm sorry to interrupt there, but I'm really happy the book started out with a story about the Edmund Fitzgerald and the tragic shipwreck of 1975. For one reason, I mentioned we've talked about my first book, So Terrible a Storm, which I wrote about 13 years ago after visiting the lighthouse with my family. And the tour guide, it might have been you, said Congress appropriated $75,000 to build the lighthouse after the great storm of 1905. And I said, I'd lived in Minnesota, like I said, for a long time, and I could talk about the weather, but I had never heard of the storm of 1905. So I fell down the rabbit hole that is history and got really obsessed with this 1905 storm, often called the Matafa blow. And we wrote the book, and the book came out, and probably three quarters of the people who ever approached or talked to me about the book, or when they heard about it, they said, oh, is this about the Edmund Fitzgerald? And, you know, the Edmund Fitzgerald, of all the shipwrecks, and I think there's like 10,000 on the Great Lakes bottoms, the Edmund Fitzgerald is clearly the most well-known, and we all owe Gordon Lightfoot credit for his kind of iconic song, The Wreck of the Edmund Fitzgerald. And I think that's just burned its way into the kind of the public psyche. So Lee, when Lee told me the story of your personal connection with that song, I said, let's start the book with that, because everybody wants to hear about the Edmund Fitzgerald. So if we open with that, I think we'll grab the reader's attention. So why don't you share your kind of personal story of when that song came on your green truck radio? I forgot exactly the make and model of your truck, but we got that in the book, I know.
Yeah, it was, you know, I started in 1982, so it was 3 years later, November 10th, 1985, so 10 years after the Fitzgerald went past Split Rock Lighthouse out onto Lake Superior and then went down in the storm. But I was driving to town right about 4 o'clock in the afternoon, just getting dark. And of course, Gordon Lightfoot's song came on the radio, as it does over and over again around November, around the Great Lakes. And yeah, I thought about it. This is the 10th anniversary. This is a kind of a special deal. I've got access to the keys to the lighthouse and to the switch for the beacon. When I get home, I'm going to go up and it'd be just dusk, and I'm going to turn the beacon on for a couple of hours and rotate it and do it in remembrance of not just the Fitzgerald crew, but the other shipwrecks on the Great Lakes and on Lake Superior especially. So we did that. I did that in 1985. And, a few people, local people driving by saw it was on and asked me about it a few days later. Oh, why was the light on? And I explained it. And the next year I did it again. And a couple people showed up just standing around down at the base of the lighthouse. And it just kind of naturally turned into a thing. And it took 4 or 5 years before we said, well, there's so many people showing up, let's kind of make it an annual thing and do an event around it. And then that's where the tolling of the ship's bell for the muster of the last watch of the crew came into being. So that became a kind of a traditional thing at Split Rock. And it was based on the Mariners church in Detroit, that they did that same thing on November 10th. And so I thought on our end of the lake, we should do something to remember them too, because some of the crew were from, one was from Silver Bay, and some others were from the area. So yeah, it just kind of grew. And I think Hayes is continuing on with the tradition, and it's as popular as ever, I believe.
Yeah. The interesting thing is, the last year, because of the pandemic, like a lot of this, even like this book launch, we had to do it virtually last year. You know, we still did the all the ceremony and the beacon lighting, but we did it all virtually. But I am happy to say this year, as long as there's no restrictions, we'll be doing this, the Edmund Fitzgerald Memorial Beacon Lighting in person this year. So if you're at all interested, mark it on your calendars, November 10th, and we'll turn the light on for you. So Lee, you raised your family here. Like you both your kids were born when you guys were living here at the lighthouse. How do you think living at a place like Split Rock, like shaped, you know, your family's life and specifically your children?
They were born in Two Harbors, grew up at the lighthouse until they went away to college. And I think being in a place like that, both it taught them a respect for history, respect for people enjoying history, and also made them appreciate their privacy when we could get it. And we're all a pretty, I don't want to say introverted family, but, you know, we play it pretty close to the vest for the most part. And I think they've continued to appreciate both sides of that. They both enjoyed immensely being outdoors. John worked in the state park for DNR for about 5 years in high school and college. Anna went on to major in environmental studies, and I think living where they did had an impact on them deciding to do that. And we did get out and enjoy a lot of the areas. When we first moved to Split Rock, there was no state park. Literally, you drove into the lighthouse. There was no park road. There were no campgrounds down below, no trails. So we just bushwhacked through along the shoreline, make our own ski trails and snowshoe trails. until later on when the park was developed. So they had an appreciation of both seeing it in its pretty raw state and then seeing it being developed.
And Lee, I think I can't remember if this is in the book or if this is a story that you told me, and I might be outing them a little bit, but I know there was a couple instances where they maybe would hide behind the fence line and toss some things at some wayward visitors as they would walk in front of the house.
Yeah, there used to be gooseberry bushes right along the fence by the front trail that goes by in front of the houses, and I think they'd hide behind the bushes and just toss gooseberries over the fence, have fun with that. And you know, I said, no, you got to cut that out, you guys. You can't be doing that.
Kids will be kids, right?
Yeah.
You know, just touching a little bit more on the family side of it here, there's a really great picture of you and your family celebrating Christmas in the house. Do you have a favorite memory of a holiday at the lighthouse?
Well, yeah, it took us quite a few years. When the kids were young, of course, we did like every other family, and we'd make the circuit to visit grandparents and family in different parts of Minnesota. And it took a few years before we said, dang it, you know, Christmas and Thanksgiving are a time that they're so special to be at the lighthouse that we finally said, no, we're going to stay home for a few Christmases and Thanksgivings. You can tell by that tree in the picture that we'd go out down, we wouldn't go in the park and cut trees, but we'd go down along the power line along Highway 61 where they were going to get chopped down anyway, and we'd find a scraggly balsam fir or spruce and put up our own Christmas tree, and it was pretty special. And there again, it's winter, and that's part of what made winter pretty special, is having those holidays together and being at home.
Yeah, it's you know, for me, this year, because of the pandemic, we stayed at the lighthouse, and it's one of those things that it almost made me feel more connected to the past that I'm surrounded by here at the lighthouse. And so I think, you know, I'm sure you probably had the same kind of feeling, where it's like, I'm actually more connected with the site and the people that came before me by having those family moments in those houses, because they lived in those houses and had those same moments as well.
Absolutely. And that really came through to me in the 80s and 90s when some of the children of the original, the very first keepers, Pete Young and Frank Koval, would come back and visit and introduce themselves. And we could talk. We'd have them into our house, which was the Koval home back in the 20s and 30s and 40s. And yeah, that's the Koval family being shown there. And we'd actually, Jane and I would get to sit on the front porch and visit with Beulah Koval, the daughter, and Ilena Koval, daughters of Frank and Edith Koval. Frank was a keeper at the time in the 40s and 30s. And hear their stories, and they'd come in the house and say, oh, I remember my mother, she planted those rose bushes. You can see a rose bush in the picture. That's still there in the yard. You know, that's part of the historic integrity of the place, is trying to keep that vegetation. And yeah, there was a real connection, and knowing that the sidewalks that are there, the keepers starting in 1910 walked those same sidewalks that you and I walked to go to the lighthouse. And it really, there is a connection. And if there's any spirits at Split Rock, it's a historic nature of the keepers and the feeling that they walk the same grounds.
So Curt, when you were researching the history of Split Rock and learning about the families that lived on site, did you see any similarities between the Radzaks and the keepers before us?
Oh, I saw tons of similarities. You know, the lighthouse was only active for 59 years, which is kind of a short time frame. It opened in 1910 after we talked about the great storm of 1905. But by 1969, the government decommissioned the lighthouse, and it sat empty for a while. And the state took it over as a historic site. So, you know, Lee's title wasn't the most exciting in the world, historic site manager. But really, he's a lighthouse keeper of the modern era. And you know, going over the book and working on the book with Lee, I learned how to, you know, how the weights work to spin and rotate the, you know, it's just information that not many people have in this 59-year period, and raising families in the same dwellings that the lighthouse keepers lived in. And And Lee kept up a great tradition that all the keepers before him did too, which was to keep a log. And sometimes the logs were pretty sparse. You know, I did a story for my column in the Star Tribune last Sunday about two assistant keepers who drowned that first year, tying a sail down in a little boat to go get the mail. You know, and the log items from that, you know, were, you know, keepers went out to get the mail and didn't come back. 8 o'clock went to look for them, found the boat. You know, it's sparse stuff, but I think keeping that written record was a great treasure, and that Lee kept that tradition going. So, yeah, really, he's a lighthouse keeper. So I like some of the pictures we've been showing when he's dressed in the proper garb. Because really, his title, like I said, he might be, sounds like a state bureaucrat, but it's a lot more exotic of a job than that.
Yeah, there he is, all dressed in his grandeur right there. The beacon on behind him, too. Curt, do you have you've done a lot of research on Split Rock. Do you have a favorite or more interesting fact that you like kind of just made you go, wow, like that's an amazing piece of history there?
Well, the one story and I mentioned that really grabbed my attention as we were kind of pouring through and figure out what made the book and what did make the book. We were a little restrained by our strategy to go season by season. And with the help of our editor, Ann Reagan, we kind of sprinkled in some sidebars, we called them. You know, in this drowning story, for those who might not have read the paper last Sunday, the head keeper, Pete Young, the original head keeper, lighthouse keeper at Split Rock, you know, had sailed all kinds of boats and could sail anything, according to his son. So he jury-rigged a little sail to go in this little 16-foot boat they called the Clinker. And he would hold on with one hand, the tiller, and one hand he would hold his sail. Well, if a big gust of wind came up, all he had to do is let go of the rope. The sail would go down and he would be fine. Well, once he caught his two assistant keepers tying that string down in the sailboat, and he said, never, ever tie that down, because one gust of wind and you'll be topside. And lo and behold, when they did disappear and not come back, Pete Young had to work all three shifts that night. They usually divvy the night watch into three, and he had to stay up all night long, I'm sure, filled with anxiety and worry about what happened to his two assistant lighthouse keepers. At 8 o'clock in the morning, he headed out and he found the boat about 200 yards off the shore. They towed it in and flipped it over, and lo and behold, that string was tied down to the boat. So here's a guy who gave all these warnings, you know, kind of countless warnings, as a head lighthouse keeper in the Great Lakes, but that one warning never to tie down the string, you know, ended up costing two lives, and the only two work-related deaths that ever happened at Split Rock.
Yeah, and that happened shortly after the lighthouse like was officially operational too. That happened very early on. So when I read the article again, I hope it realized to people like how remote this area was and how dangerous of a job this actually was. When they're up here, Lee, do you have a favorite or kind of one of these most interesting facts or episodes in Split Rock history that kind of sticks out in your mind?
Oh boy, there's so many. I liked some of the in the early keepers' logs, and there was one assistant keeper, Harry Thompson, that kept his own journal on the side, and we have that. The Minnesota Historical Society has that, and he would talk about. You know, there was a little Two Harbors fishing village about a quarter of a mile from the lighthouse right down in the cove. So that was the keeper's nearest neighbors. And he would talk about going down there and they'd get haircuts sometimes. They'd once in a while a keg of beer would come into the fishing village, and he talks about going down there and helping them drink some beer or going grouse hunting back in the woods. So there's they related to the environment around there, the keepers did, you know, pretty similarly to the way I did in the later years. I mean, fishing village wasn't there and the beer wasn't there, but the nature and the wildlife was there. So that was all part of it. But other stories, there's so many that it's hard to pick a favorite one that comes to mind, but
it's worth pointing out too, that the highway didn't come up to Split Rock for until the 1920s. So you had several years where it was as remote as the cliff top is now. You know, back in the first decade or so, you know, it was really isolated. You could only get there by boat. Supplies could only come in from Duluth, you know, on a supply boat every once in a while. So you think about how isolated that spot can be now. It's worth remembering for a while. There was no road to get there.
Yeah. And they, when they refer the, to me, it, the something that just always sticks out is actually the construction of the lighthouse itself and like how much of an engineering feat that that actually was, you know, for them to get the hoist engine up, you know, up that cliff on its own without the hoist there, like not using any mechanics. And then, you know, blasting and building the lighthouse itself, to me, I'm just still in awe. I'm just trying to process how they did all of that. And I always tell people they did it, you know, they got it done ahead of schedule and under budget. That never happens today. Like, you know, for them to do that is really remarkable. And I just kind of get astounded by that. And the fact that there was running water in the houses too, especially in 1910, you wouldn't expect that in a place up in northern Minnesota. So it's truly a engineering marvel up when they were first building it.
Yeah, and the way that the site evolved in the early days, that first they had to pump water from the lake, and mm-hmm. it wasn't until the 1940s that they drilled a well or had electricity. It was kerosene lamps prior to that. So they were isolated and a long ways from the supply chain, and they did have a telephone in 1915 that they could call out, but other than that, they were on their own.
You know, and you bring up the telephone too, Lee. The funny thing is the keepers had to pay for that themselves, because the lighthouse service said, no, we do all of our official communication by pen and paper and snail mail. So you don't need that telephone. So then they ended up, the keepers pooled their money together and got the phone in there. And then I know the tour guides here like to give the story of the lightning strike and the lightning and the fireballs shooting out through all the faucets in the house and coming through the telephone is kind of an interesting. I think they maybe elaborate on it a little too much sometimes.
Yeah, you know, that was a true story, because I've had that related by the Koval daughters about the lightning strike. But in all the 36 and a half years I was there, I never saw a lightning strike out on the lake, actually onto mm-hmm. the water. But it never hit any of the buildings. So I think the lightning prevention method that they put in place were helpful and did the trick. But I always expected that to happen, but it never did.
One of my favorite anecdotes in your family history up on the shore, you talked about one time the weather and conditions were just perfect for Lake Superior, believe it or not, to freeze over. And I think it was you and your son who found a bunch of hockey puck-sized pebbles and got your hockey sticks and skates on. Tell that story a little bit, because I love that story.
It's so rare that that happens. I mean, it's about every, 10 years or so that the lake will freeze over as far as you can see from Split Rock. But it's real rare that it'll freeze over without snow falling on it right away, and just freeze into a flat, clear surface that you can go out and stand on and look down and see the giant boulders, you know, 10 or 20 feet below the surface. And it froze probably 4 or 5 inches thick. And John was a hockey player from Silver Bay, and I still had my skates. So we went out with a couple of hockey sticks and took the little rocks along the shore, and we were shooting them, and they'd just sail across the lake as, you know, couple hundred yards or all the way over to Little Two Harbors. It was so smooth. And that happened very rarely, maybe 2 or 3 times in the years we were there.
You know, Lee, you also talk in the book too about these dirty nor'easters that come across the lake. They'll kind of catch people off guard. And there's also a story when you guys were, you know, out in your canoe in the lake and you almost got caught off guard by one. Do you want to tell that one a little bit?
Oh, yeah. Dirty Nor'westers. That's what the old commercial fisherman, Walter Svay, who fished and still lives just down the shore by the Split Rock River, that's what he called them, as dirty Nor'westers, and they hated them. It was the summer storms, the big thunderstorms that would come up over the North Shore from behind the hills, and those big thunderheads would come up and just start gusty winds and, you know, lightning and thunder. And we, at one time, we were going to take the canoe out, and Jane and I portaged the canoe down to the shore and dead calm, just a totally calm day. And this, we took the kids and put on the life preserves, and we're just going to paddle over to Little Two Harbors right along the shore, not go out from shore. But this was a time that the wind came up off the lake from out on the northeast, and it's kind of called a backdoor cold front is what the meteorologists call it up there. When all of a sudden that cold air will come across the lake really quickly and start to blow, and the temperature will drop 20 degrees in about 5 minutes. And that wind came up, and we had to get into shore over by Little Two Harbors and pull the canoe out, and I had to hoof it back to the lighthouse to get my truck and go down and get the canoe and the kids and Jane and pick them up from down there. But it's nothing to mess with. That lake, you never know what it's going to do, and you can't trust it at all. And it's cold. It's always cold.
Yeah, the few times I've gone and kayaked out there, I was actually just out there on Tuesday. The lake was just like glass, and it was so hot. It was nice to get on the lake because it was cooler. But when you're out there and you look up at the lighthouse from the water, you know, it's a really cool perspective, but it puts things in perspective for you on how small you are in this tiny 14
foot. That's right.
And you're like, this lake could just swallow me up really quick.
Yeah. And it always surprises me in the summer if I see somebody out there on those stand-up paddle boards or goofing around out there on their own, that, boy, it's just, I don't even like to watch them, because it's you don't want to know what's going to happen.
Curt, have you ever gone out in Lake Superior on a kayak?
We did on the South Shore around the Apostle Islands a few years ago. My wife and I took a kayak trip, and it was fantastic. And part of the Wilderness Inquiries group we were with, part of the little practice session they had, you had to tip your boat over in the lake. You know, just not that was going to happen. These were long, safe kayaks. And we went, you know, up and down and explored the caves around the Apostle Islands, which was fantastic. But I think it's a good idea to just dunk yourself in there, just so you know how cold that water can be. If anything happened, you know, the first thing you're supposed to do is make sure your partner's okay, you're the other person in the boat, and get out of that water, because it's cold. And I remember the chill plunging in there on our little kayak trip. But yeah, what a beautiful lake, but what a scary lake too. So you got to be careful up there.
Well, next time you come up, I'll put you in one of my kayaks, and we'll go out together, and I'll get you right under the cliff, so you can get that view that Lee and I have seen a couple times. So
we have stand up paddle boards. Lee sounds like he's not endorsing our use of those crafts.
Not for me, anyway.
You know, nature and living on site is really intertwined, and we try to do that here on site. About the you know, with the tours that we give, we really try to connect people with the site and the lake and how the relationship is with the lake there. And one of the things, Lee, that you talk about in your book is the night sky. And I have truly just fallen in love with the night sky up here myself. I'm from southern Minnesota. I used to see a lot of stars. And when I moved into town, I never really realized how much I missed all those stars. But here at Split Rock, the sky is alive. Do you wanna talk a little bit more about this? And maybe you have a favorite moment of yourself when you were out just stargazing?
Yeah, that's one of the things that just is just awe-inspiring, is how dark it is up there. And in that photo that's up on the screen now that you took, you'll notice across the lake, that's the South Shore of Wisconsin, 25 miles away. And that's probably Washburn and Ashland, those little light puddles you see on the horizon. You didn't see that stuff back in the 1980s and 90s. You could see a little light bubble down by Duluth and Two Harbors, but there was a lot less light in the sky. And it's kind of unfortunate how that's changing. And I know there's a lot of people that want to keep by what's called the Dark Skies Initiative. And it's still that if you stand at the lighthouse and look out, or anywhere along the shore and look out towards the lake, it is black and you see stars you never knew existed. We, like for the Edmund Fitzgerald event, when we talk to people from the Twin Cities or that come from metropolitan areas, we have to tell them if they call ahead, be prepared, dress warm, and bring a flashlight. Because if you have to park down in the state park and walk up the trails, it is so dark. And people aren't used to it being that dark that you cannot see the hand in front of your face. And that makes for gorgeous night skies and meteors and northern lights, satellites. Of course, you can see it's amazing how many satellites are up there.
Oh, the satellites have gotten a lot more prevalent, even in the last year that I've been up on site. That I walked out the front door the other day facing the lake, and Starlink was literally like going right over the top of the house. And at first I'm like, this is really cool. But this at some point is going to wreck the night sky because it's just so dark. And just like you said, you can just stare up at it and just be in amazement. And the thing, I had a moment about seeing the northern lights for the first time at the site. And it was one of these moments where I felt more connected back with the past that I'm surrounded by, where it's like, I'm probably seeing something that the keepers before me would stand out in awe and just have those same feelings. And it's a magical moment.
Yeah.
So the other thing with living on site is wildlife, all sorts of wildlife encounters. And I've had a couple few here, but Lee, you had many, many wildlife encounters here on site. And do you want to, that we've got a bear incident, and then we also have a certain bobcat that you kind of befriended over time.
Well, I'd say the bobcat befriended us, and that was kind of towards the end of our tenure there, the last couple of years, this bobcat. And I think it's a pretty young bobcat because it's fairly small, was hanging around. And in this case, he was on a bird feeder because we had some suet hanging there, and he thought that was easy picking. So that's the bobcat story. And he hung around, and I understand you still see him from time to time. Of course, everybody likes to see the big mammals, the wolves and the bears and the moose, and we've seen plenty of them up there. The bear story.
Yeah, the bear story. Oh. I know Ann Reagan, our Cracker Jack editor, is wincing if she's watching this because she wanted us probably to talk about the bear in the bathrobe story long ago. So no further ado, tell us about how you ended up confronting a bear in your bathrobe.
All right. First, I want to clarify that it was me in the bathrobe and not the bear in the bathrobe. This was back in, I suppose, the mid-1990s when there was a lot of trouble with bears along the North Shore, and especially in the state park. The campground was getting set up. They didn't have the bear-proof containers. We just had garbage cans on the historic site. So it was attracting bears, and bears can be a nuisance around people and garbage. So I gave the DNR a call and said, we have one bear in particular that's really being a nuisance, and knocking over garbage cans, even knocking over our dumpster. And can you bring in a culvert trap? And for people that know, a culvert trap is a big culvert, like a ditch culvert that they put ends on it. And it's got a guillotine door that on a rope that the bear goes in and grabs some bait, and it pulls a rope and the door comes down, and then they can haul the bear away and transplant it somewhere else. So that was a case here. They brought in a trap in the afternoon, and at night I heard the bear out in the parking lot, and this was in the middle of the summer, so it was nice and warm. So I got up and I told Jane, I want to set that trap and see if we can catch the bear. We had chicken for supper, and there was the remains of the chicken in the garbage. So I grabbed the bones and what was left of it and threw on my bathrobe and wandered out into the parking lot and raised the door on the trap with the rope. And I had the chicken in one hand, the rope in the other hand, and in my bathrobe. And at the same time, all of a sudden, I look up and the bear is standing on its rear legs, rear paws, right on the other side of the trap from me. And he's about 6 feet tall. and looking at that chicken in my hand. So I'm holding the door open, and I just reached around and threw the chicken carcass into the trap. And his nose, he followed his nose right into the trap, went inside after the chicken, and I let go of the rope. And we had the bear, and I went back in my bathrobe, and things were quieter after that. But I saved the bathrobe. I didn't lose it to the bear.
Sorry if we spoiled one of the best stories in the book for those who haven't read it yet. But the bear the bathrobe. Yeah, I guess it was Lee in the bathrobe to remind people.
That's correct.
Curt, you've spent a lot of time with Lee. Is there anything else that you need to pull out of him here while we have him kind of on the hot seat?
Well, I did hear for the first time tonight about your kids chucking gooseberries at the visitors. He kept that out of the earlier story. Maybe that'll be in the sequel.
Well, we did have a crab apple tree in the yard too, and there might have been some crab apples involved in that too. That I had to put a stop to them picking the crab apples and tossing them over the fence. But
I think third readers will be surprised too about the book, and I was surprised as we kind of honed it into shape that there's really a lot of great bird watching stories in the book. So, you know, not only were there big bears and bobcats, but the bird sightings and the migrations of the birds that come over Lake Superior, I thought was fascinating, from, you know, the big birds to the little birds. So if you like birds, you'll like this book a lot. If you like lighthouses, you'll really like this book. So I joked with Lee that he's kind of the Henry David Thoreau of, instead of Walden Pond, he's at Split Rock Lighthouse.
Wow, that's good. I'm honored. Yeah, you're right. The birds, you know, there's the hawk migration that follows the shore down to Hawk Ridge and Duluth and beyond. And now there's nesting peregrine falcons. We always enjoyed the ravens. There was a resident raven family for quite a few years that made a nest right in front of the cliff. And watching those adults raise the kids and listening to them squawk at 4 a.m. In the summer, it was fun. You know, it was fun to see, to be that close to nature and to see it changing through the year.
Yeah, the peregrines are actually nesting in the raven's nest this year underneath the lighthouse, and they were squawking this morning at 4 a.m. I can verify that. they are quite loud. And then the funny part is I had the ravens. I was trying to get the eclipse this morning, and I came back at about 5 o'clock because it was cloudy. And there was like four ravens sitting at the base, like right below the lighthouse. It was kind of creepy all at the same time, but they were there squawking too. So, so I think I'm getting word that we have a couple questions coming into chat. So I think we're going to do a little bit of Q&A here. We'll put both of you on the hot seat here. So when they come up, I will read them out and we'll see what we got. We got Pam who's asking, can you talk about the challenges that the isolation of the lighthouse in the early years posed for the early keeper? So Lee, you want to tackle that one?
Sure. Like we mentioned earlier, there was really no running water. They had to get their water out of the lake, no electricity. Different than a lot of lighthouses at the time, the island lighthouses were, a lot of them were bachelor lighthouses. They didn't allow wives at them. Split Rock was kind of the top-notch desirable place for the keepers to be stationed, and a lot of them wanted to, especially if they had family, because they could have their wives and children there. Of course, you got to remember that they were only there during the shipping season. So they had to move their whole family away in the fall and at the end of the shipping season, and about mid-December when it shut down for the year, they'd move back to Two Harbors or Duluth or wherever their permanent homes were. And then in early April, they'd move back up to Split Rock and have to heat up all the buildings, fire everything up, move to their, it's like going away to the lake in the summer. So it wasn't their permanent homes. Until about 1931, they were given permission to live there year-round. That was about 5-6 years after the highway was built, so they could get back and forth. And then a couple of years later, in the early 30s, they had a road into the lighthouse so they could take their own automobiles and get in and out more easily. But those early years, yeah, it was pretty tough. And I'm sure it was tough for the wives of the keepers, especially because they had, especially if they had young children, and they had to, there was no fences at the time. So they, those kids had to know to stay back from that cliff edge. You know, our kids had it pretty good. Your kids do that. There was a fence there now. Mm-hmm. But back in the day, back before the late 30s, there was the sidewalk in front of the houses, between the houses and the cliff, and it just gradually dropped off for about 30 feet out and then went straight down. So those children had to know not to go beyond that sidewalk. And I'm sure it was stressful for the families to be there. But other than that, you know, those kids talk about very good times living there too, and having some of the same experiences.
And they had to be pretty self-sufficient too. Like, you know, there was no, you know, Super One or Zups up here where you could go to the grocery store easily. So they would have to do a lot of hunting, a lot of, you know, fabricating of their own, you know, furniture and all of that stuff. So there was a lot of manual labor that was that they had to do, and they had to do it year round when they lived here on site year round. So
yeah, and they did get resupplied by the lighthouse tender boat two or three times a summer, and they'd bring in some of the bigger supplies, or the steamer America was making three times a week, making a trip up the shore and would pull in either into Beaver Bay or pull up in front of Split Rock if they had personnel or supplies to drop off. And then the keepers would have to row out and meet the America and pick up the supplies that they had ordered. But yeah, it wasn't a quick run to the store. And now it's still 10 miles to the closest grocery store, but it's a lot easier to get there, unless it's fall color weekend and Highway 61 is packed.
Then yeah, then you just so stay good. Home.
Yeah.
All right. Marlon's asking, what type of maintenance has been required to keep the lighthouse intact on the cliff?
That's a great question. Buildings, especially in a location like the North Shore and along Lake Superior, it's not a marine environment that it's salt water, but it's fresh water, and there's a huge freeze-thaw cycle, so the buildings really take a beating. Mm-hmm. And in the years I was there, there were four major restoration, stabilization, preservation projects on the lighthouse, the keeper's dwellings, the storage barns, the fog signal building. And some of those, say the centennial restoration right before the centennial in 2009, the centennial was 2010, there was a restoration project, and that was over $1 million just to stabilize the buildings and make sure they'd be good for another 20 or 30 years. Yeah, scaffolding was built around the lighthouse, and it was enclosed, and the brick was protected, the concrete belt course, some of the different concrete areas, and the cast iron lantern, that black top part of the lighthouse, had to be stabilized. New windows put in. But when you think that all those 11 buildings for the light station in 1910 were built, 1909 were built for under $75,000, and then we had to put $1 million into it. And that's, you know, the state of Minnesota deserves a lot of credit. The state legislature did bonding for some of this. There were some lighthouse preservation funds nationally that we tapped into. But yeah, there's a lot of upkeep that has to be done on those. And even now, if you look at the wall, the exterior walls on the lighthouse, you can see some vertical cracks that are running up and down it that are going to have to be addressed in the future. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the maintenance is never ending on historic buildings, that's for sure.
Right. But it's worth it.
Yep. So Gina is asking, how does Lee feel living in a quote-unquote normal house now, and do you miss the lighthouse a lot?
That's a good question, and Jane and I talk about it. You know, we miss the house a lot. Because, you know, it was our house and it's where our kids grew up. We miss Lake Superior a lot. We miss that. Yeah, there's the view. Yeah. Right, that's out of the bedroom window, the master window upstairs. So we miss that. You know, the job is great, and I miss the job, but the aspect of the 24/7 of it. I don't miss as much as we miss the location and the actual fact that we were privileged enough to live there and make it our home. So yeah, it's different living. You know, we're living in West Central Minnesota now, and you know, the thing we miss, the dark skies. It never gets dark at night because we're pretty close to town. Instead of hearing the fog horns on the passing ships, we're hearing railroad horns going by. So it's never as quiet as it was up there, and we never get that long distance view that we could out the front window. So yeah, it's an adjustment.
Let's see. Reed is asking, what was the worst storm that you endured during your tenure at the lighthouse?
Oh boy. There are probably five major nor'easters that usually come in November, December, or March and April. Some of those, you know, there were times when the waves had hit the side of the cliff, and I don't know how it did it, but it would actually rattle the windows in the house. Those windows are never tight to begin with, and they leaked quite a bit. In a good blow, you can actually watch the shades. If you have the shades pulled on the inside of the window, you can see them moving in the breeze. So they're not that weather tight, even with the storm windows on. You know, the one that I think I remember, and the kids probably remember, even though they were pretty young, was the Halloween blizzard of 1991. And there we got about 36 inches of snow in a couple days. And we were on our way to take the kids to a Halloween party in Silver Bay. And, you know, they were all dressed up in their costumes. And we got a mile or so from the lighthouse. And we said, no, we got to turn around and go back. And we barely made it up the hill into the state park and back to our house, and then the snow just kept on for a couple days, and we were stuck there, and that snow stayed till spring. It was there in May still from that one storm. So that was a pretty memorable storm. But the big ones to remember are the ones off the lake where they pound you with the waves and will last for 2 or 3 days and 70 mile an hour winds. 1992, there was a big storm in November that I remember taking video shots of the waves actually rolling all the way up into the woods along the shore down below the lighthouse, knocking big rocks from the shore back into the trees. Yeah, it's pretty impressive.
One of the more memorable little anecdotes in the book that I enjoyed too was not on a stormy night, but you had befriended one of the boat captains out on the water. Tell the story about you had a cell phone call with the guy, and he was nice enough to give a blast. Tell that story a little bit, because that one just riveted me anyway.
Yeah, that was interesting. You know, this was towards the last couple of years we were there, and I went into the VA clinic for something down in Superior, and one of the women that worked there, an older woman, we started talking about what I did, and she said, oh, my son is the wheelsman on the Edgar Spear, which is one of the big 1,000-footers. And I said, well, I've always wanted to be on one of those. And I've always wondered about the foghorns, how long it takes them to get to shore and what it takes to blow them. So she said, well, I'll give him your phone number. I'll give you his, and you guys can communicate. So one night about midnight, he gave a call and said, well, we're going to be going by Split Rock. We're 9 miles out. If you want to go outside and see if you can hear the foghorns. It was clear, perfectly clear night, cold night. Jane and I and Anna walked up by the lighthouse, and we could see the lights way out on the lake from the spear, the line of little lights. And I had him on the cell phone. I said, okay, we're here. You want to sound them? And he said, yeah, I will. It might wake up the crew, because it was totally clear and they didn't need to sound them. So he blasted the horns. And he said, I'm going to sound both of them at once. And I didn't even know they had the option of doing one or the other, or if there were multiples. But he said, okay, I just sounded it. And we waited. And we waited about a good half a minute. And finally we heard it. And it gave us an idea of how far out on the lake they were. And it was loud. You know, we could certainly tell it was them sounding the horn. And I ran up into the lighthouse and I turned on the beacon and I said, can you see the beacon from there? And he said, oh yeah, I could read a newspaper from it, because I stopped it right on the ship as it went by, and it was still out in the shipping lane about 9 miles away. But he said it's very bright and still works as well as it ever did 100 years ago. So that was kind of a neat story, and I got to know a guy on the boats, but I never did get out onto one of the big ore carriers to go across the lake. Dang it.
Although maybe you're lucky, because I keep flashing back to before Split Rock was there. You know, we mentioned the 1905 storm that led to the construction of the lighthouse. And during that storm, the Madeira, you know, back in those days, boats would often tow a barge behind them, and they'd call it to sail in consort. Well, in this storm, the rope attaching two boats, the Madeira being the barge, split off, and it came crashing towards and sinking right where Split Rock Lighthouse is now. So it's a popular scuba diving spot. You know, but the story that rings out to me that really grabbed my attention, that kind of got me hooked on the whole Split Rock history, I think there were 9 or 10 crew members on this barge that had no controls. It comes crashing into the rocks of Split Rock. And there was a seaman named Fred Benson, a long forgotten name, but he actually, as the boat was smashing into the cliffs, he kind of timed the waves and leaped almost like a monkey onto the cliff face. You imagine the pelting weather and the waves slamming into him, you know, in this November gale. And he scurries with a rope in his hand up the whole cliff, 130 feet to the top, somehow throws the rope down and saves all but one member of the crew. I think the first mate died that night, you know, but you talk about some drama. Imagine being there in 1905 during that storm when Fred Benson scales the cliff and throws the rope down and saves most of the crew. I mean, those stories, you couldn't make up better fiction stories than the nonfiction stories that happened up on that clifftop.
Yeah. I think we got a few more questions that have come in. Rachel is asking, do you think that you would spend almost 4 decades on the site when you first got this job? So did you ever think that you would have been in this office for almost 40 years, Lee?
Well, I wasn't in that office to begin with. My office was over in the third keeper's house in the living room for the first 4 or 5 years until the visitor center was built. But no, when we were newly married and we moved up there, and Jane and I kind of said to each other, well, let's give it 2-3 years and see how it goes. And then look at it after that. That came along and we said, well, let's give it 5 years. And by then the kids had come along and we were enjoying it so much that, you know, we didn't have any kind of target in mind. It was a very interesting job for me. It was a great place for us to live. The Minnesota Historical Society is a fantastic employer. I loved working in history. It was just the perfect fit. And there was so much variety, both in the landscape and in the job itself, the interpretation, the preservation, the maintenance, everything else, that it just fit. And by golly, going from 30 years old when I started to retiring at 67, I never would have thought that I'd stay that long, but it really worked out and it fit well. Good luck, Hayes. I hope you, you know, and the other thing is that I kind of totaled it up when we were actually at the lighthouse for a third of the total history of the lighthouse from 1910 until 2019 when I retired, and a third of that we were there. And it's awesome to think that we could do that, and we're lucky enough to be able to do that.
Yeah, it's Lee, you and your family have contributed immensely to the site's history. You've done a great job up here. You laid a great framework for me to come in and take care of the site moving forward. And you've definitely earned the retirement, and it's, you know, the Split Rock is what it is because of your commitment and your passion for it too. So I think we are going to wrap it up. I do have to give two little plugs here, because if you want to see Lee actually in person, He will be up here on June 19th signing copies of his book that Curt has right there. He'll be on site from 1 until 6 p.m. Hey, Lee even has his own copy of his book.
Yeah, I'll autograph it too.
Yeah, and so he'll be on site June 19th, once again, 1 to 6 p.m. here up at Split Rock. We're doing a book signing. And then we also are doing a special event. I can't give too many details about it, but put it this way. It's on July 31st. It's going to be really awesome. Lee's going to be a part of it. So watch out the website, mnhs.org/splitrock for all the details on that one. It's going to be an amazing event on July 31st. I'm really, really excited for this one. Curt, I really want to thank you for all your help with Lee here and helping with the book. And Lee, once again, thank you so much for your passion and your commitment for Split Rock and for Minnesota history as well. So.
Well, thank you, Hayes. And it's good to pass the baton to somebody younger that knows social media and knows how to deal with all that stuff. That when I started, it was a dial-up phone and a snail mail is the way I stayed in touch. And Curt, I really appreciated working with you because, you know, we didn't get to see each other much because of the pandemic, but we talked a lot over the computer and emails, and you were fantastic to work with and a great help. I couldn't have done it without you.
Yeah, it was an honor and a thrill. And I couldn't be happier with the final outcome. Great job.
Yeah, me too. Thanks.
Well, thank you everybody for attending. And if you're interested in a copy of the book, check out the Minnesota Historical Society's website. I'm sure you can get it there. Or come up to Split Rock. We are open 7 days a week and we have plenty of copies of books here. And when Lee comes up, we'll make sure he signs every single copy we have. So if you've got any left over, you'll get a signed copy. So thank you, everybody.
Thanks.
Thank you.